Hey everyone, Michael Alm here. So this week I am testing out the Shaper Origin. I've wanted a CNC in my shop for a long time, but I don't want to dedicate the floor space to it in here. And this, I think, is the perfect solution to that problem. I reached out to the people at Shaper. They offered to let me test it out in my shop for a little bit. So I'm excited to have it here, give it a good test run, and share it with you guys. So stick around. For those of you who haven't heard of the Shaper Origin before, it is a handheld CNC machine, which basically means that it is a router that is computer controlled. The cool thing about it is it fits inside of this small box. You can bring it onto a job site, you can work with it in your shop and tuck it away in a corner. It's super handy because it doesn't take up any floor space. The tool comes with a quick start guide, which I found really useful, and a tool pouch that contains all of the odds and ends that you're gonna need when you work with Origin. The tool pouch contains two rolls of the Shaper tape, which we'll get into the details of that in a minute, as well as a wrench to unlock the collet of the spindle and an Allen key to remove the spindle from the body of the machine. There are three router bits that come with it, and there's one SD card that you can use to transfer files onto the machine. So the first thing to do when you get the machine is to remove the little parts that hold the spindle into place. You are going to keep these because if you ever transport the tool, you want to lock that spindle into place so that it doesn't bang around. And once those are removed, you can remove the spindle to install the router bit. Like I said, the tool comes with three router bits. The first one is a V cut bit for engraving. Second one is a 1/4 inch spiral up cut bit. And the third one is an 1/8 inch spiral up cut bit. With the router bit installed, I could put the spindle back into place. It slips in with a keyway in the back and then use the Allen wrench to tighten it down. The spindle plugs into the side of the machine, and then a dust shroud goes in front. That just clips in with magnets. The last thing to do is to attach the hose to it, and you are ready to turn the tool on. One of the things that weirded me out about the tool at first is that it doesn't have an on-off switch. I thought this was the on-off switch, but that's just for the spindle. It actually just turns on its own when you plug it in. Much like a cell phone or any other electronic device these days, you need to connect to a Wi-Fi network to update the software. You don't have to be on the Wi-Fi all the time, but it's definitely good when you first get the tool to be on Wi-Fi and update it. While it was updating, I decided to work on the design for my first cut with Origin. And for that, I'm using Adobe Illustrator, which is a program that I already know fairly well, but the nice thing is that Origin doesn't have any proprietary software. It basically allows you to use a whole bunch of different softwares, and throughout this video, I'm gonna show a couple different options. This, I just literally took my logo from a file that I already had, loaded it into their template, and just sized it up to the size that I wanted. You don't have to use the template, but it just helps for sort of programming. They use these guides on the left-hand side to figure out what the tool wants to do. You can change all of those things internally in the tool, but if you want to prep beforehand, you can choose what kind of cut style you want when the tool is going. Once you have it all programmed, you can delete the design guide and save the file. You want to save this as an SVG file. That's a scalable vector graphic. I think you might see me save it as an AI, but you're supposed to save it as an SVG. So just make note of that. So with my file saved properly and Origin all updated, I can plug the SD card into the tool and get ready to make my first cut. In order for Origin to know where it is in space, it uses this stuff called Shaper tape. And the shaper tape you just lay down onto your work surface. I recommend putting a little bit more than I did on this one. It's definitely my first time using it. But once it's laid out, you can scan that area and create what they call a workspace. These workspaces are super handy because they're saved internally in the tool. So if you have to return to make a cut and you haven't moved the tape at all, you can unplug the tool and come back the next day, plug it back in, and recut the same exact spot. It's really impressive. With the workspace established, now I can place my logo, and it's just a matter of pressing a button. There's definitely a more precise way to do this, which I'll go into later. I quickly Z out the spindle so it knows how deep to cut, and then after that, I am ready to go. I start with sort of like a roughing pass in the beginning, and that's just to remove as much material as possible. You can see the display shows me how much I've removed and how much I have left to remove, and it also gives me crosshairs to follow as I go along. The blue lines are areas that I've been, the gray area is what I still have to remove. After it's roughed out, I can then move to cutting right against the lines. And this works basically the same way. You'll see the crosshairs again, and it actually, those marching ants follow the direction that you need to move the router in, so you don't do a climb cut or anything. It's really user-friendly, and you'll see here in a second that if I go a little bit beyond, it actually retracts the bit and then allows me to put it back into place and start again. From this angle, you can really see how Origin uses its motors to correct itself. It's super cool to watch. Well, I am really happy with that. For the first thing I've done with Origin, that is really, really good. You can see I made a couple mistakes. I kept forgetting to lift the spindle out of the cut, and so I got a couple gouges. The tool corrects for that, it lifts it out, but there's a little bit of a delay on that. So that's just something that I think I'm gonna get used to as I use the tool a lot more. Other than that, I think it looks great. You could fill this with epoxy, you could make an inlay for it, it would look pretty incredible that way. It's just really impressive, and to think that that was just from an Illustrator file that I didn't have to alter at all. Really, really cool. So next up, I think I'm gonna work on some small parts, some things that I'll probably need to build a jig for, but I wanna see how it handles like little details and stuff. So let's do that next. After spending some time on the Shaper website and going through the forums, I noticed that a lot of people build jigs sort of like this. This is what I would call a bench hook. It goes right up against workbench, and then this is gonna be the space that is your workspace. So I'm making two of these. I'm making one that's 1/2 inch thick and one that's 3/4 inch thick. This one's the 1/2 inch, and I'm just doing 4 screws in each corner and then covering the surface with Shaper tape. In order to make sure that the 1/2 inch piece and the 3/4 inch piece line up with each other, I'm just using those screw holes to mark the place and then countersinking them on the 3/4 inch board. I can then attach the 3/4 inch board and apply more Shaper tape to that as well. Now that I have both of those panels, I can scan them into Origin and set up a workspace. And this shows how you can use workspaces. You can actually name them and keep them saved. You can even update them if you decide to change the tape or if the tape wears out over time. It's really easy to do. So I'm gonna be cutting out a piece of pattern plywood, and I wanted to have a backer board on there. So I just used double-sided carpet tape and put this 1/4 inch backer board on and made sure that it was nice and flush. Then I can add carpet tape to the pattern plywood and set it right up against the fence, and then we're ready to go. I told you that there are better ways to set up to make sure that you know exactly where you are in space, and what they refer to that as is the grid. You use 3 points with the bit descended, and then you can figure out exactly where that corner is so that you can measure off of it into the negative and cut your design. In this case, it's just a 4-inch rounded sided box. You can place it exactly in space. You can see on the top, it's got an X and Y, and that indicates how far away you are from that grid. With my design placed, I am ready to cut once again. I'm using a 1/4-inch upcut bit for this so that I can remove as much material as possible. And just a quick note on depth, when it comes to cutting, they say if you've got a 1/4-inch bit, you can cut a 1/4-inch deep, and if you've got an 1/8-inch bit, you can cut an 1/8-inch deep per pass. So this took 2 cuts to roughly cut 1/2-inch worth of depth. I decided, because I was worried about how fragile the pattern plywood is, to swap out my 1/4-inch bit for an 1/8-inch bit. And I wanted to mention that you don't have to use shaper bits for this. In fact, you can use any router bits that are corresponding with the collet. And I found that Royce Tooling has a lot of great choices when it comes to different bits that you want to use for your router. So in this case, I'm using an extra long 1/8-inch bit from them, and it worked like a charm. If you want to pick up some router bits from Royce Tools, there is an offer code. You just enter almfab at checkout and you'll get 10% off. Really happy with that. That turned out really good, and other than a little bit of burning around the edges, which I think was actually caused by me moving the tool too slowly, it turned out really good. A little bit of sanding, looks perfect, and yeah, the cool thing is that I can take that same exact file and put down like a piece of walnut or something, and I can inset the piece into that. So yeah, I'm digging it. The other thing is the jig worked out great, and cereal boxes make good shims to bring it up to the right height as the material. I don't even know if I need a 1/2-inch panel, because I can adjust both sides, you know, with pieces of 1/4-inch plywood or whatever. Yeah, definitely recommend making this if you have Origin. Now I'm going to work on some joinery. I've got a bench that I'm working on for a friend, and I need to make some tracks in it. I'm doing another tambour piece. It's going to be the next video, and I think Origin is going to be perfect for that. Quick tip for organizing the cords and hoses with Origin. I really like using these Velcro straps. I use these on a whole bunch of different tools. They just wrap around the cord, and then you can wrap them around whatever else. They come in rolls now, which I think is super handy. I'll post a link down below to where you can find them. As I mentioned before, there are multiple ways of designing paths for Origin, and in this case, this is SketchUp. I use SketchUp a ton, so I was happy to see that they have a plugin that you can download and then create an SVG file from a flat plane. So you can see here, it looks black, but if you click on it, it has all of the information, and then you export that out with a simple right click and save that to your hard drive. Once that's saved, you just hop on Shaper Hub. This is something that is provided with the tool. If you buy the tool, you have a Shaper Hub account, and you can upload directly to the hub. From there, it connects via Wi-Fi, and you can just import it directly from the tool. So we're now getting to the stuff that I think I'm going to be using Origin for a lot, and that's joinery, especially things like stop dados and tracks, things that are really hard to do with a traditional router. You can build templates and use a guide bearing and all that stuff, but the setup is very hard and it's hard to dial in. With Origin, I'm able to make multiple cuts in the same groove and shift my offsets outward until I get that perfect fit. I chose the middle track to just test this out on, just to make sure that everything fit really nicely. And I'm super impressed. It actually felt like normal woodworking, where you're sneaking up on a cut, sort of like you would on a table saw. It was kind of fun, actually. And I mean, the fit speaks for itself. Now that I had the test fit under my belt and I was feeling more confident with the tool, I decided just to go for it and cut out all the tracks. So there are three stop dados in there that are receive three panels that support the body of the cabinet. And then there is a 1/4 inch panel behind those, as well as a 1/2 inch track that goes around the outside, and a 1/4 inch track on the back that receives the very back panel. All that was done with the same router bit. So I still have more to do on the bench, but I'm gonna stop for now because I've covered a lot on this tool and there's loads more to cover. If you guys want another video on Origin, please let me know in the comments down below. It's capable of a lot more. It can do finger joints and dovetails, all sorts of crazy stuff. My takeaway with this tool is that it's just very powerful. It is $2,500, nothing to scoff at, for sure. That's an expensive tool. But it's the sort of tool that you can actually build a business or a side hustle around. You can make custom signs, you can make fancy pieces of furniture in your garage. I mean, this is a really powerful tool, and I'm really impressed by it. By the way, Shaper's not paying for this video. They didn't even ask for a video. They didn't even ask for any content. They just wanted my input on how I liked the machine. And I felt so impressed by it that I wanted to make a full video on it. So. There it is. If you have any questions, ask them in the comments down below. And if you want to catch another video, here's a playlist right here. This video will come out next week. There's the spoiler for you. It's just so good. Anyway, I'll catch you in the next one. Bye.